Welcome. In this Coolgrad video, we're going to talk about Agile best practices training. This video is particularly useful for people who work in Agile projects in IT industry, and also for those who aspire to become Scrum Masters. Scrum Master is a particular role that's like a project coordinator almost, you know, who manages the team of developers, QA, business analysts, and technical architects, and helps the entire team in an Agile project. So we're going to talk about different project methodologies and the particular features of Agile projects. So let's talk about the different project methodologies. So there's waterfall, agile, hybrid. So a waterfall project is one in which we do the development first, and then, you know, we do things in a sequential manner. So first we do all the high level planning, and then do all the design, and then do all the development or the coding, and then do all the QA or testing, and then we do the UAD, and then launch to production. So things happen like in a waterfall, step by step. Sequentially, that's a waterfall methodology. So some projects are particularly suited for waterfall methodology. So if the business team is outsourcing a waterfall based project to some implementation partner, they will probably see the design at the end of all the design, and probably they would have a showcase once in a few months, and maybe till the end they don't really get to see what's going on. And so it's not really conducive for people to give periodic feedback. Only when there is a showcase once in a while, the business team will be able to review and give feedback for incorporation. So, but then some projects, especially like in the manufacturing industry, they might be highly conducive for the waterfall methodology. They're suited to be done in this particular way. Agile. So Agile methodology is a recently newly developed methodology wherein it's all iterative. So the entire project implementation is done in cycles. So there is a periodic showcasing, and there's periodic incorporation of feedback from the product owners. So in an Agile project, there is something called a sprint, which is, it can be 1 week, 2 weeks, 3 weeks, or 4 weeks long. It's like a period of time. So usually a sprint is like 2 or 3 weeks long. So in one sprint, the people do some amount of design, some amount of development, some amount of testing and showcasing, and at the end of the sprint there is a demo to the business team. So the business team can review and incorporate feedback and make changes. So every sprint, you know, the project is done iteratively. Iterative development, iterative testing, and iterative showcasing. So, but then the UAT in an Agile project happens at the end of all the sprints before launching to production. So hybrid. So in a hybrid project, development happens iteratively in sprints, but there's usually no testing or QA done during the sprint cycles. And all the testing is usually done at the end of all the sprints. So the QA and then the UAT is done at the end of all the sprint cycles. So that's like a mixture, mix between waterfall and agile. Advantage of agile over waterfall and hybrid. So one of the clear advantages is that in agile methodology, the customer or the business owners get to see what is being developed, what is being showcased periodically. And if there is something that needs to be redesigned, they can redesign it. And if something is wrong, they can say it every 2 weeks or every sprint cycle. And so there is more accountability, and there is more transparency, and the entire team knows what's happening. You know, projects do fail even when you're using agile methodology, but it lets you catch it faster. So if it's going to fail, you can see it earlier and catch it and probably try and remedy it. But and there are some projects like Salesforce CRM is a type of software. So Salesforce projects are designed to be and meant to be executed only using agile methodology. And if you use any other methodologies like waterfall or hybrid, the results are not guaranteed. So for best results, Salesforce projects especially have to be done using agile methodology. So let's talk about some common terms used in agile methodology. For example, what is a user story? So the business team wants certain features developed, and they outsource it to an implementation partner, to the team members, to implement it for them. So how do they capture all their business requirements? Where do they write what exactly they want to be developed in this application? So a user story is an artifact. It's captured in a tool like Rally, Jira, TFS, Team Foundation Server, or you know, there are so many other tools. So in this tool, there is something called a user story. So the product owners, the business team, they create a new user story and populate all their business requirements in this story. So if they're designing a website, they specify how they want the login page to look, how they want the home page to look, and then what functionality in the My Profile page, and how the payment gateway must be integrated. So all these requirements are populated in user stories and how it navigates from one story to another. The functionality of each item on the page is all listed out in these user stories. So the product owners write their business requirements and acceptance criteria, and the business analysts translate these business requirements and acceptance criteria into system level specifications. For example, if you're designing a website like Facebook.com, the business team may say on the homepage, I want this logo, I want this login, I want this message, I want all these things and this color and all these things. But then how do you tell the developer what to develop? So a business systems analyst or a business analyst comes into picture, and then they translate these business requirements into system level specifications. They may tell the developer, use this particular color code, this font, and draw a text box here, and code it such a way that it accepts the username only 50 characters long, and you know, all these specifications, put this button here, when you click on this button, it must take you to this page. So all these system level specifications are written by the business systems analyst. And the technical architects, they populate the architectural details. So that's the underlying database design and the overall functional dependency between various artifacts. It also contains details of which person is working on which story. So for each story, it is owned by the product owner. And then who is the business analyst assigned to this story? And who is the QA person assigned to this story? Which technical architect is working on this story? So usually there's like drop-downs in a user story. So the team members can populate their names from the drop-down. They say, okay, person A is the technical architect, person B is the QA person on this story, and person C is the developer who was working on this story. So that's for traceability later on. So a user story contains all these details in a tool like Rally, Jira, or TFS, or some other tool. A user story may also have attachments. So we can have Excel attachments sometimes if there is a lot of data to be populated. We can have screenshots of how the UI should look. So you can attach Word documents of some specifications. So we can have a whole lot of specifications in user stories. Each user story goes through a life cycle from creation, grooming, development, testing, product owner testing, and then closure. So each user story has a life cycle. First, the product owner creates it, and then in the grooming phase, we try to populate all the details and make it ready for development to be picked up in a sprint. So once it's in the sprint, it goes through development. The developer codes what's in the story, and then it goes through testing, and then the product owner testing or the UAT, and then it's closed out at the end of the sprint. So I'm going to talk about that in more detail later on. What is a sprint? A sprint is a period of time, a 1 week, 2 week, 3 week, or a 4 week period. So usually sprints cannot be more than 4 weeks long, but very rarely we have like 2 day, 3 day, sprint cycles. So usually it's at least 1 week long. And most of the time sprint cycles are 2 weeks or 3 weeks long. So suppose we have a 2 week sprint. What it means is it has a start date and an end date. For example, if it's starting on Monday of this week, ends on the Friday of next week. So it's a 2 week sprint. And the entire team must know what work we are supposed to do in the sprint. So we pick up these particular user stories and we have to develop them completely, test them, and showcase it to the product owners, incorporate feedback, and then demo it at the end of the sprint and then close it out. And whatever is not closed out, we have to do whatever is needed to be done. So Each sprint starts with a sprint planning session to determine the workload that's ready to be developed. So whatever is in the product backlog, that's like where all the user stories reside. So we groom certain user stories. We put in all the details and get the entire team to review it and get all the doubts clarified. And then in the sprint planning session, we say, this story is ready to be developed. And we pick it up. And in the sprint planning session, suppose the team capacity, it has 10 members. Then suppose they work about like, let's say 8 hours a day. So in a 10-day sprint, how many hours do we have approximately? We may have about, say, 10 developers working for 10 days, 8 hours a day. So that's about 800 hours. So we pick up stories worth 800 hours. So for each story, we put in the level of effort estimation. This can be in the form of story points or hours. We say, how many hours is it going to take to develop this story? This might take 30 hours, this might take 60 hours. It's all done during the sprint planning session. And then we sum it all up and we say, we have a capacity of 800 hours. So in this sprint planning session for this upcoming sprint, let's pick up stories worth 800 hours. So you pick up 20 stories, 30 stories. The number of stories is not important. It's the number of hours that's important. Sometimes you may have only two stories and they may take up 800 hours because they're such big, complex stories, which involve a lot of testing. But sometimes you may have like 60 stories and it still takes only 800 hours. So the number of stories is not really important. It's the amount of work you pick up that's important. Each sprint ends with a sprint demo, where all the completed functionality is showcased to the entire team. So the product owners and the business analysts and the QA and the dev leads, they're all the technical architects, the scrum master, they're all in the team meeting. And the business analysts or the QA leads, usually they showcase the completed functionality to the entire team. And if there's any open defects, if there's P1 or P2 defects open, then we probably can't close out the story. But if there's some minor defects, it's okay. If they were happy with the functionality, then they close out the stories at the end of the sprint. What is user story grooming? The process of populating all the details into a user story to make it ready to be picked up in a sprint for development is what is called grooming. So product owners populate business requirements and acceptance criteria. Business systems analysts translate the business requirements into system-level specifications for the developers to code. Technical architects populate architectural details for that story. And team members review the story and get their doubts clarified. So this whole process of creation and getting a story ready is called grooming a story. So once they've got all the details populated, that is the business requirements and then the system-level specifications, the architectural details, for the user story, then usually the developer leads and the QA leads and the business analysts, they collaborate and assign the level of effort for each story. That is the number of story points, or it could be in terms of hours. So there's something called like poker planning sometimes that's done during sprint planning. Different projects assign a level of effort in different ways. Sometimes they may use like Fibonacci series, that is 1, 2, 3, 5, 8, and 13, and so on, up to 20 points. So each story is given a level of complexity. This is a one-pointer, means it's a very simple story. This is a half-pointer, means it's just probably like a spelling mistake change or something. This is a three-pointer, this is a five-pointer, this is an eight-pointer, or this is a 13-point story. So they assign complexity based on collaboration and consensus. So that is how user stories, complexity and level of effort are assigned. And sometimes they directly put in the hours. So they may say, this might take about 2 hours to do. That includes development and testing. So this might take 2 hours, this might take 5 hours, this might take 10 hours, this might take 30 hours. They assign complexity for the stories. So when all the developers, QA and the concerned team members have reviewed the story and got their clarifications, the dev lead sets the user story to team review done. So once all the details are populated and the level of effort is populated, they give it to the team members. So all the developers, the testers, everyone reviews the story. And then if they have any doubts, they're like, hey, you know what, I don't understand this object you used here. I don't understand what this means. Oh, this is not clear. They get all their doubts clarified from the concerned people. And then they arrive at a consensus, and then the dev lead or the BSA, they mark it as team review done. So the entire team has reviewed it, they're clear on the story. During the sprint planning session, the day before the sprint, there's a sprint planning session. It's a meeting. The team discusses which stories are ready and which ones are high priority to be developed and tested right now. So there might be 100 stories which have all the details populated. But we may not have the capacity to pick up 100 stories in the sprint that's starting the next day. We may have the capacity to pick up only 800 hours of work. So what do? We pick up the stories that are highly critical and important along the business process. So this story needs to be executed before the other one needs to be done. This story needs to be done, you know, before this can be done because of a functional dependency. This story cannot be done now because it's waiting on a third-party software. And this story cannot be picked up because the product owner is going to be on vacation for the next 2 weeks. So for various reasons, some stories we cannot pick them up. And whatever stories are ready from those, we pick those which are of highest priority, which are important and also urgent to be implemented. So then those stories are picked up in the sprint, and we say, suppose we pick up 25 stories worth approximately 100 story points. So that is the capacity of the team, and that's what we're going to do. Usually they pick up about 40 to 50 story points. It really depends on each project. So sometimes you may have only 3 or 4 stories picked up, but then it still amounts to 40 story points or 800 hours. So the planned velocity is how much you pick up in the sprint planning meeting. How many story points or how many hours of work you pick up, that is the planned velocity. So whatever you pick up, you're supposed to develop and test and deliver and close out at the end of the sprint. So let's talk about the different roles in an Agile team. So we have product owners, project managers, Scrum Masters, Business Systems Analysts, developers, and QA, along with, you know, some technical architects sometimes. So these are the basic roles in an Agile project team. So who is a product owner? A product owner, or a PO, is the business representative from the client company, usually, who decides and specifies the business requirements and acceptance criteria. So if you're designing a website, he tries to design the functionality, what goes where, how we navigate from page to page, and then what exactly we expect from this website, and what is the objective, what does the customer really want. So if it's a manufacturing project, for example, if you're designing a simple box, the business requirements come from the product owners. He will tell you whether he wants a box made of gold or silver or copper or iron. And he tells you what must be the length and breadth and depth of this box. And he tells you what must be the approximate weight and what must be the level of polishing and what must be the design on the surface. And all these specifications come from the product owners or the business team. So they prepare the standard business process flows in collaboration with the rest of the team. So a business process flow diagram is usually prepared in MS Visio or some such software, wherein we say in each block of the process we are supposed to write which actor performs which action in which system. So we say for example if it's a Salesforce project, so we say the help desk agent logs in on the home page over here, and then next what happens when he clicks on the login button, it takes you to the cases page, and then if a customer calls, and next what happens, either a case is automatically created or the help desk agent receives the phone call and manually creates a case, and then we have to give a notification and a case ID to the customer. So all these actions are captured in a business process flow diagram. So the product owner is also responsible for creating user stories in the correct hierarchical structure in Rally or Jira or TFS or whichever tool we're using. So assuming we're using Rally because that's like a very popular tool. So the product owner is responsible for creating user stories. First, they create usually like a high-level business process flow diagram. And for every block in the business process, they have to make sure it's covered in a story. So they create user stories. And then once they put in, the product owners put in the business requirements, then it goes to the business analysts and the technical architects, and they groom the story, and then they execute, develop it and test it, and then showcase it back to the product owners. So the product owners are the ones who first create the user story and populate the acceptance criteria and business requirements. So for whichever story, there might be multiple product owners in a team, in a project. So whichever stories they're working on, they are the owners for that story. And in the drop-down, they're supposed to pick their name saying, I'm in charge of the story. I'm the product owner in charge of this user story. So initially, when a story is created, it's usually in like a backlog status or added to backlog. So that's usually the first status. And then it goes to like, you know, under grooming, and then in development, in QA, and then closed out. So when the functionality is developed and tested, they usually showcase it to the product owners on a periodic basis. So, and then the product owners are supposed to play around during the sprint. Just before the demo, they're supposed to play around and do something called product owner testing. So what we call POT, just to differentiate it from the UAT, which happens at the end of all sprints. So in every sprint, they do something called product owner testing, and they play around, and if they find any defects, they point it out to the team and log defects. On the last day of the sprint, during the sprint demo, they give their, you know, opinion about which stories are ready to be closed out and which are not ready to be closed out. Business Systems Analyst, or BSA. BSAs may be from the client or from the implementation partner. It happens, sometimes they're from the client, sometimes they're from the system integrator. So the BSA is responsible for reviewing the stories created by the product owners, and they decide which stories are doable and which are not doable. And whichever stories are feasible, they take them up, and others, they arrive at a consensus and, you know, reject them. So, and in the user story, the BSA has to populate his name saying, I'm the BSA in charge for this story. And they understand the business requirements of the product owners, provide inputs to design the functionality, and they translate the business requirements into system level specifications for implementations by the developers, explaining the various out-of-the-box features and functionality that is available in the software, explaining the pros and cons of different methods of solutioning a desired functionality. So a product owner may say, you know, I want this functionality to be done this way. But it's the business systems analyst, the BSA, who's supposed to educate the business team about the different ways in which we could implement a particular functionality and what are the pros and cons of doing it in each way. So they may say, out of the box, we can do it this way. This involves very less level of effort, but this is the functionality you get. But by minimum configuration of the page layout, we can do it this way. And this is the level of effort increase, and this is what you get. And if you want mass code level customization, you can do it and you can get this whole thing. But do you really want to put in this level of effort for that? So, and they're supposed to explain what happens. If you do it this way, it's going to hit there. It's going to affect the other module. They're supposed to explain the functional dependencies to the product owners. They're supposed to also explain the technical system level specifications. What happens if you do it this way? They're supposed to educate the product owners. They're supposed to review the function and technical design provided by the technical architects for user stories. And the BSA gets to mark a story ready, sprint ready, during the sprint planning session for the sprint. So only a BSA can mark the story sprint ready. So the product owners might see things only from a business perspective, and the technical architect might only see things from a technical perspective. But a BSA is usually expected to have overall understanding of what's going on. And a BSA gets to determine whether a story is sprint ready or not. So it's usually done by consensus, but the BSA gets to mark it sprint ready. And the business systems analyst also reviews test cases written by the QA team. And they provide inputs to testers about, you know, some missing info in the test cases or about how to update some test cases. And they showcase the completed stories which have been tested in a sprint, and then they incorporate feedback from the product owners. They showcase tested stories and then close them out at the end of the sprint. So a project manager, That's another role in a project team. A project manager is different from a product owner. Product owner is more from the business team. Project manager is the one who manages multiple dimensions of a project, including budget, scope of work, the timeline, quality, risks, contingencies, resources, stakeholder satisfaction, among other things. It's a very prominent role. So usually if a client is implementing a project, they may have an in-house project manager, or they may have a project manager from the system integrator who is implementing the project. So the project manager has to manage the budget. They have to prepare all these Gantt charts using MS Project, and they're supposed to identify functional dependencies, and they say, this is the level of effort it would take, and they decide what is the billing rate for each of the resources, and they say, these are the resources we would supply, and it's going to cost you $2 million or $5 million, whatever. So they prepare the project proposal and the budget, and they have to get it approved by the client. And they have to get the business requirements documents from the client, and they have to understand, they analyze the BRD and prepare something called their interpretation of the BRD, which is a statement of work. And once they are clear about what is expected to be done in the project, they tell the client, you know, this is the scope of work, and they have it all laid out clean in the minutest detail, and there should be very little scope for ambiguity. So, and if there's any changes that come later on, that should come as a change request. And if there's any enhancement that come later on, that must come as an enhancement request. So if the customer initially asks for a box made of gold of this particular size and this particular design, and then they say, you know what, I would rather, and after 2 months they say, you know what, I'd rather change the size of the box to some other size, smaller size, that's a change request. They have to reevaluate the level of effort that would take to make this change and the impact that it would have. And suddenly they cannot come and say, you know, I asked you for a box made of gold, but now I think I changed my mind, I want a box of silver. That has to come through a change request. Or initially they may say, I want a box of gold of this particular design and size. And then they say, on top of this box of gold, I want a spear made of copper. So that is an enhancement request. It wasn't specified earlier, it comes as an enhancement request. So the project manager must maintain the budget and the scope of work and the timeline. So if the system integrator commits to delivering the project in 2 years, he has to deliver it in 2 years. And if you miss the deadline, it's a kind of failure. So of all these dimensions, it's like juggling all these balls in the air at once, 6 balls at least. So there's budget, scope of work, timeline, quality, resource satisfaction, and stakeholder satisfaction. So they have to make all these things successful. So sometimes, and then the project manager is also in charge of the quality. Sometimes there's a separate QA manager, but ultimately the project manager is also kind of accountable for the quality of the project. So just because you have to do it in the particular time frame within this budget, you can't give them a product that's full of bugs and defects. You also have to maintain quality. If there's a separate QA manager, he helps the project manager by taking care of the quality assurance process. He is responsible for risks and contingency identification. So he identifies, if you do it this way, it's going to impact this functionality. If you do it this way, it's going to affect us by, you know, delaying the timeline. They have to make a risk log, and in every PMO, I mean project management office meeting, they're supposed to escalate the concerns to the entire executive team, and they're supposed to identify contingencies. How are we going to work around these problems? Resources. So usually the resources report to the project manager. They might report to a lead or sometimes directly to the project manager. So they're supposed to manage their KPIs, key performance indicators, make sure the resources are performing well, the resources are happy, they're not overworked. You know, sometimes they manage to get the project, you know, go live exactly at the specified timeline and with all the quality good and everything, but the resources are so exhausted that two of them might have to be admitted in the hospital because they couldn't withstand the stress. You don't want that to happen. They have to manage the resources' time off, their vacations, they have to make sure the resources are happy, they're not you know, having problems with other team members, you know, all these things. So ultimately, if the project is a web, the application looks really nice, but the resources are complaining, then also the project is kind of a failure. So it's like 360 degree assessment. A project manager has to make sure everything is okay. And it's not easy, believe me. And then they have to make sure the stakeholders are happy. So ultimately, it's the sponsor who's paying for this project. They have to be happy ultimately, make sure that they're happy in every way. So they have to procure qualified resources, get them interviewed and onboard them, make them familiar with the processes, make them sign all the, you know, non-disclosure agreements and stuff, and, you know, finalize their billing rate, make sure they get the payments on time, and setting KPIs for performance reviews, make sure the resources are performing well, and help the product owners identify functional dependencies in the business processes. Generate various reports and metrics to communicate the project's health to the executive management. So every PMO meeting, they usually have all these various features that need to be assessed. And it's marked either like green, yellow, or red. So green means it's healthy, it's doing well. Yellow or orange means, you know, there are some concerns when you look at it. Mark red means there's a big problem, so we got to look into it. And then, so the project manager also prepares the PMO status reports in every PMO meeting. And then they perform, you know, they prepare the sprint plans and strategies and revise them periodically. So a sprint plan is about how many sprints we can conduct in parallel and what stories can be picked up before we pick up other stories in a sprint. And then how many sprints do we need? We have to identify, you know, how much time we would need to execute this process, this entire project. What can be done in parallel and what has to be done sequentially? Because not everything can be done in parallel. Preparing a sprint plan itself is like a complex task because it's like an inexperienced or naive project manager would say, hey, you know what, I have all these things that could be, you know, chunked out and, you know, we can do these things by having 9 sprints in parallel, deliver it in 1 month. But as, you know, we have a joke in the IT industry which says, you know, it takes one woman 9 months to make a healthy baby. You can't use 9 women and have a baby in 1 month. So they have to identify what can be done in parallel and what not and how many resources we have and how we can stretch the timeline. And they have to come up with a sprint plan, which gives a good timeline and appropriate number of resources and budget. So they have to help the team members resolve interpersonal issues in collaboration with the Scrum Masters and other people. They review change requests and manage the change process too. Technical architect's responsibilities. So a technical architect is usually one that works at the database level and higher than that, and they work with all these functional and technical dependencies. They link systems to each other. So in the user story, there is a drop-down called technical architect in charge, and they pick their name saying, I'm the technical architect in charge of the story. They provide functional and technical design for user stories, and then they design how each story must be solutioned. And then after the entire story has been reviewed, so once all the details are populated during the grooming process, the business product owners have populated the business requirements and acceptance criteria, and then the business systems analyst have provided system level specifications, and then the technical architect puts in his details and he says it's ready for team review. So the entire team can review the user story now. And then after the team review is done, the BSA says team review done. They provide clarifications on all technical issues to the resources. Developers' responsibilities. So developers are usually from the implementation partner or the system integrator. And these developers, they are the ones who actually program and code the user story. So whatever stories are marked ready for team review, the developers have to review them and get their doubts clarified from the product owners and technical architects and business systems analysts. And after reviewing the stories, they do the actual coding and configuration and customization and writing SQL queries. They do all the, you know, technical programming. And then they write something called unit test to make sure, you know, they test what they coded and make sure it's working fine. And then they mock the code migration ready, meaning they tell the release engineer the build is ready to be deployed to the next environment, that is the QA environment. Once it goes to the QA environment, it's ready to be tested by the QA team. So the QA analyst responsibilities. The QA members are testers, and they're usually, they might be from the client and also from the implementation partner. So they're responsible for authoring positive, negative, UI, and regression and scale test cases. So they're supposed to write all these test cases for manual testing. And if you're using automated software, then they are supposed to, you know, train the software and, you know, record the training and then train the software to capture the functionality and execute the test cases automatically. So whatever stories are marked ready for QA or in QA, in the QA environment, they execute the test cases and test the functionality and make sure it's working fine. And they log defects. So while testing, if something's not working fine, they log defects and get them fixed. And they make sure the defects are closed and resolved and closed on a timely basis. Marking stories QA complete when testing is completed. So after all, for a particular story, they execute all the test cases and then they mark it QA complete, saying, I finished testing the story. And at some point when the stories are QA complete, the release engineer moves it into another org called the UAT org, where product owners can test it sometimes. They have a separate org, a separate environment for that. By the way, an environment is called an org in Salesforce, so I'm just sometimes using those terms interchangeably. An org is nothing but an environment. So they help the business analyst showcase the stories to the product owners in the sprint demo, and then they get the stories closed out. They make sure the UI, positive, negative, regression testing, everything is done, and they also check for browser compatibility. So it has to work in like Chrome, Safari, Firefox, Internet Explorer 10 and 11 version. So they have to like make sure it's working on all the browsers. Release engineers' responsibilities. So release engineer may be from the implementation partner, sometimes also from the client. And they migrate the code between various environments. So from the developer's environment to the QA, where the testing happens, and then from there to the UAT environment, where the UAT happens, and then from there to production. So they perform smoke testing of the code in each environment to make sure the basic functionality is working fine. And they refresh orgs from production periodically, means whatever's in production, sometimes it might be updated through hot fixes, and sometimes they may have to do like a back refresh, especially in Salesforce. They have to, you know, migrate code backwards sometimes to make sure all the orgs have the latest version of code. So they're responsible for building, making the build and merging the code and, you know, deploying it from one environment to another. Scrum Master's responsibilities. So Scrum Master lays out the Agile and QA best practices in a project. So using a tool like Rally, Jira, or TFS, they train the entire team. Sometimes the company might be implementing an Agile project for the first time. They know nothing about Agile. They're used to like a waterfall methodology. And usually if you train them the right way in Agile, they love Agile so much that they never want to go back to waterfall. It happens a lot of times. So they customize Agile methodology for each company, you know, in a custom way. So training the entire team to use the best practices correctly. They organize a daily Scrum call. So what is a Scrum call? It's usually a 15-minute call that happens every day, usually. So where the team members, each one of them, they go around and talk about what they did in the past 24 hours, what they're going to do in the next working day. And if they have any impediments, they bring it up in the Scrum call. So the Scrum Master has to maintain an impediment log saying these are all the impediments raised by the team members. And then they think about facilitating resolution of these impediments. So who's going to take charge of resolving these impediments? And then they see, is this been resolved? What can we do to do better? Scrum Master is not necessarily a task master saying, hey, you said you would do this, why haven't you done it? That's not what a Scrum Master is supposed to do. A Scrum Master is more like an advisory coach, an agile coach. So Agile teams, Scrum teams are like self-evolving teams. So people learn to play around in interpersonal, and then they learn to gel and work together. And sometimes if members are not able to work in a particular team, they might put them on two separate teams. I've had to do that sometimes in my teams. And so Scrum Master tries to automate the communication between team members. So we use something called like a hot potato, a feature. I'm going to elaborate that later. So suppose one team member wants another team member to provide some input on a user story or a defect or something. You don't have to walk up to them or send them an email. So we give them something called a hot potato. So in the user story, there's a drop down and called hot potato, and we pick their person's name and we say, and we put a note saying, this is what I want you to do. And the person gets a notification from Rally or whichever tool, and that person knows, oh, okay, so this person is expecting me to work on this story. I have a hot potato, so they have to respond within 24 hours. That's usually the way we automate communication in a team. Scrum Master is also responsible for organizing the sprint planning, sprint demo, and the sprint retrospective for each sprint. I'm going to elaborate on that later. Sprint planning is when we decide what we're going to do in the upcoming sprint. Sprint demo is what happens on the last day of the sprint when we're going to showcase all the completed functionality. And sprint retrospective is a meeting that happens soon after, which says, what did we do well, what did we not do well, and what can we do better? That's sprint retrospective. So the Scrum Master also ensures that stories are progressing at an optimal burn down rate. Means that enough stories are being developed and tested throughout the sprint. We don't wait till the last moment for things to happen. They generate various reports for the management. There are reports about the defects, reports about the burn down rate, and then there's the cumulative burn up rate, and there are all kinds of built-in and custom reports in Rally and Jira and all these tools. So the Scrum Master can also generate a lot of reports for the executive management so they can monitor the health of the project and the sprints. So they're supposed to keep the team members focused on their activities, and they're also responsible for publishing sprint metrics at the end of every sprint. At the end of every sprint, they publish a, usually I used to do it in Excel, like a sprint metrics. I used to send out an email saying, we picked up this amount of work and we were able to deliver this percentage of what we picked up. So the planned velocity was say 100 hours, or say 800 hours, but the actual velocity was 600 hours. Means we got 600 hours of stories closed out and the remaining 200 hours were not closed out. So the closure rate was 600 divided by 800. That is actual velocity divided by planned velocity. That is 600 by 800, that's about like 75% closure rate. So whatever rejected stories we have in a sprint, they move it back into defined status, or they push it into a future sprint as determined by the product owners. Why stories may not be sprint ready, even though they have information populated. Sometimes stories have all the information populated, looks like it's ready to be picked up in the upcoming sprint. But in the sprint planning meeting, they decide we can't really pick up this story. Why? Sometimes there might be some missing info which people didn't realize earlier. During the sprint planning, they look and say, the technical architect says, oh, you know what, I don't have this particular input from the BSA or something like that. Some missing info, so it's not really ready. Or sometimes the story may have functional dependencies on some other stories that have not been implemented. So this story cannot be done until these two stories are done. So that kind of, you know, functional dependency. And then the story may be dependent on some third-party software or tool that the IT department has not yet procured. So maybe they need a tool like, say, DocuSign for e-sign, that's electronic signature of a document. Until the IT department procures that tool, which will happen 2 months later, we cannot implement this story. The story may have low business priority. The story may be already, but then there may be other stories which are more important and critical and urgent that need to be done. So this team members may have limited capacity, saying the story is urgent and critical, but there's only this many resources, and so we have to pick up the ones that are more urgent and more critical. So there may be a limitation of the team capacity. Absence of key players in the team. The story may be all ready, but then the BSA is going to go on vacation for 2 weeks. The BSA who's in charge of this particular story. So BSA is a very key member, or the developer who's supposed to work on the story is going to be on vacation for 2 weeks. So we can't probably get this story done. So absence of key members sometimes prevents you from picking up a story that has all the information. So just because the story is groomed and has all the information doesn't necessarily mean that it's sprint ready, means ready to be picked up in the immediately upcoming sprint. So planned and actual velocity of a sprint. So as I've talked about this earlier, the planned velocity is a direct function of the capacity of the team. So one mistake that I've noticed people make is that they assume that team members are going to work 8 hours a day. But of these 8 hours, at least 2 hours are spent in, you know, communicating with each other, getting doubts clarified, and also maybe checking their emails and other stuff. So there's usually only 6 productive hours in the day. So if I were calculating the capacity of a planned velocity for a sprint of 2 weeks, that has like 10 days. So suppose I have 10 resources and 6 productive hours every day from each resource. So 10 resources working 10 hours a day, 6 hours. 10 resources working for 10 days at a rate of 6 productive hours per day. So that's about 600 productive hours. That would be the planned velocity of the sprint. If you shoot for 800 hours, you may not get a 100% closure rate, and you might be surprised or disappointed. So be realistic. It's okay to be optimistic, but better than being optimistic or pessimistic, be realistic. So planned velocity is the number of story points picked up at the beginning of the sprint. So actual velocity is the total number of story points that are completed and closed out at the end of the sprint. Suppose we picked up 600 hours and we are able to close out successfully only 500 hours. Meaning the other 100 hours belong to like 2 user stories which have some major defects. They are not done completely. So 500 divided by 600, that's the closure rate. The actual velocity divided by planned velocity. The closure rate is also called the acceptance rate sometimes. So 5 by 6, that would be like the acceptance rate, about, I don't know, 83%. And so all the sprint-related activities are categorized into 3 types of activities. One is pre-sprint, during sprint, and post-sprint. So before a sprint happens, what all needs to be done? Create the artifacts, folders, test plans, hierarchical structure. So in Rally or Jira or TFS, usually we store the artifacts in hierarchical structure. There's an initiative, under that we have money features, under features we have epic stories. Epic stories have a lot of child stories, which are the individual user stories. So a user story is one block, and many user stories which belong to a particular module are linked under epic stories. And many epic stories are linked under one feature. So creating this hierarchical structure needs to be done. And then input details in the user stories and categorize them in accordance with the applicable hierarchy as per business processes, linked to the business process flows. So according to the business process flow, we create the user stories and then we link them to the business processes to make sure that every item in the business process is covered under some user story, and whatever is in the user story belongs to some block in the business process. Groom the future sprint backlog. So the product backlog means the collection of all the stories. Sprint backlog means what we're going to pick up in this particular sprint. So identify what we're going to pick up in the sprint and then, you know, create the structure and try to groom it, make the stories ready. This all this happens before the sprint, pre-sprint activities. So during a sprint, the stories which we have picked up must be developed and tested. So assign the correct state to the user story so it goes through a life cycle, and then navigate the story through the life cycle. Review the functionality that has been developed, execute test cases, log and fix defects, determine acceptability of implementation. So develop it, test it, showcase to the product owners, and then in the sprint demo, we have to make sure that the story is closed out, try and get it closed out. Conduct sprint demos and periodic showcasing to the stakeholders for their feedback. And that all happens during the sprint. And post-sprint, so remember, during one sprint, we spend about 50% of the time developing testing stories which were picked up, and we spend about 50% of the time grooming for the upcoming sprint. So both these things have to happen in parallel. And post-sprint, so what happens at the end of the sprint? We have to publish the sprint metrics, saying we picked up this much, we did this much, and this is the closure rate. And then conduct a sprint retrospective to determine what went well, what did not go well, and what can we do better. resolve interpersonal issues. And then whatever stories could not be closed out in that sprint, we try and move it to the appropriate future sprint. Usually they move to the next sprint, but sometimes we determine this story cannot be done till 2 months later because we really didn't understand it till we tried to develop it. So it requires a whole architectural change, which can happen only after 2 months. So it's moved into a much future sprint. Pre-sprint activities. So we talked about this in quite some detail. We bucket stories in appropriate sprints. So the Scrum Master creates each sprint in like Rally or whichever tool, saying from the 1st of the month till the 15th of this month is going to be sprint number 1. And next sprint is going to be for the next 15 days. And then we're going to have a 3-week sprint. That's sprint number 3. So these buckets, sprints are created. And so whatever user stories we have, we bucket them in the appropriate sprints. So the team members can know which ones to group. During sprint activities. So during sprint, they develop stories in order of priority. So even within a sprint, some particular stories need to be developed before the others can be developed. So there's a functional dependency. So the stories have to be developed. And then developing a story. So set the story status to in development when they start working on the story until it's fully developed and unit tested. So we say it's in development. And when the developer has finished unit testing, then we mark it ready for QA. And they mark it, then they move it to the QA environment. And then the testers test it. And then there's a periodic showcase of stories. Sometimes in some teams they have a daily showcase. Sometimes it's kind of redundant. So they, each BSA, whenever his story is developed and unit test, then they showcase it. And then they take feedback and again develop it. So there's usually periodic showcasing that happens. Sometimes there's like a fixed showcase time, like say twice a week. So all the team members are there in the 1-hour showcase or something like that. So different projects do it differently, but a periodic showcase has to happen. And it's usually the BSA who showcases the functionality to the product owners and the rest of the team. So code migration. So move it from the development org to the QA environment. So the testers are not supposed to be playing around. Nobody's supposed to be playing around in the development environment other than the developers. So testing must happen in the QA environment. So in QA, so when the testing is happening, stories are marked in QA status, and then at the end of all the, and during the QA they log defects, and there's something called a bug triage. So in my QA best practices training, I've talked elaborately about bug triages. It's a meeting that happens like maybe daily or maybe twice a week or thrice a week, and in the bug triage they decide, they try to identify the underlying root cause of all these defects, and then they mark these, they assign the defects to the particular developer to fix it and then retest it, and then they close out the defects. So once the story is QA complete, they give it to the product owners to retest and close. So the product owner test. So at the end of the sprint, before the sprint demo, the product owner plays around in the QA environment, and if they can find any defects, they log it and get them closed out. And then in the sprint demo, they make sure all the stories are closed out. And then end of sprint demo is a session where the entire team is usually present. And sometimes only the dev leads and QA leads and only the lead level people are present and not the individual team members. So the team members get to see the functionality, the product owners specifically. They review what's being done and they give their inputs and feedback. How often to promote code from development to QA? So if you're doing extreme programming, that's a methodology, so they have to, you know, migrate code like every day, at the end of every single day. But in some projects, whenever a build is ready, whenever they've done a sizable amount of work, like once in 2 days or 3 days, they migrated from the development to QA environment. And in some projects, they might migrate it only once in a week. So it really depends. It's done differently in different projects, depending on how the situation is in that project. So post-sprint activities. So sprint retrospective, and then we promote the code to further orgs. So from the QA org, we move it to like the UAT org, where people can perform the UAT, which is done at the end of all the sprints. Or, you know, we give it to a select team of UAT testers to test. And whatever stories were not closed in a particular sprint, we move it to future sprints. One bit of advice is when a story is not closed out for whatever reason, we don't usually move it back into product backlog. We move it into some future sprint. Bucket it in some future sprint. That's usually what we do. So the sprint planning meeting is when what happens at the beginning of a sprint, beginning of every sprint, where we decide what stories are sprint ready and how much back workload we're going to pick up in the sprint, depending on how many resources are in that particular sprint, and we, you know, plan the sprint. That's sprint planning. Sprint demo is what happens at the end of every sprint. We showcase the completed functionality, and then we, you know, review the open bugs and decide which story can be closed out, which cannot be closed out. Sprint retrospective is something that happens like the day after the sprint is closed out or something like that. Where, you know, all the team members, sometimes they use stickies and they go put up, you know, stickies saying what went well. Sometimes they just voice their opinions and the Scrum Master makes a note of all this in the log and publishes it on SharePoint or something. And they say, what all did we do really well? What did we not do well? And what can we do better going forward? So it's how the team evolves in an Agile. Usually it's can be made very interesting with a lot of games and you know, team bonding activities, and then resolve impediments, and then they also determine what should be the planned velocity for future sprints. So in this sprint we picked up 600 hours and we couldn't deliver only 400 hours. So for the next sprint, should we even pick up 600 hours? Or should we better pick up 500 hours and deliver 500? What's important is to get 100% closure rate. You pick up 500, deliver 500 is better than picking up more than you can deliver and then getting disappointed. So they also try to determine the appropriate planned velocity for upcoming sprints. Sprint exit criteria. So the Scrum Master gets to determine when a sprint is officially closed out. So to say a sprint is done, we have to have the sprint demo and then the sprint retrospective. All the test cases and test steps have been executed. You know, value projectize is one of the tools. It's like Rally, you know, so I've used that over there. So the results of test execution have been indicated. The code is stable in the QA environment. Defects have been logged for every failed test case. Defects have been addressed appropriately. Product owners have tested the functionality and they're happy. And sprint demo is done, sprint metrics have been published, and even the retrospective has to be done, and then we say the code has been migrated from that particular environment into some specific environment where the client can test it. If that's a requirement, that also has to be done. And then we say the sprint is ready to be closed out. Sprint exit criteria have to be well defined. And the Scrum Master says the sprint is officially closed. So this is about the user story lifecycle. So there are various statuses in the drop-down which says, like usually initially it's in the backlog. So the product owner has just created the story and they've just, you know, put a title in there and saying this is the product owner in charge, put a brief description. But then grooming is when the product owner, the business analyst, the subject matter experts, the technical architect, all these people are populating details and getting it ready for team review. And if a particular story is not feasible, the business analyst decides, okay, the business team, they want this done, but we can't do this in this particular system for whatever reason. And then they move it to the parking lot or junkyard and then they just reject the story. Ready for a team review. So, once the business requirements and system level specifications and tech architectural details are in there, the story is ready for team review by the entire team. So when all the developers, testers, everyone has reviewed all the story details, they mark the story team review done. Sprint ready. So if the story is ready to be picked up in the upcoming sprint during the sprint planning session, the business systems analyst can mark the story sprint ready. So all this constitutes the grooming phase of a user story, in the life cycle of a user story. So in dev, this is during the sprint. So the story is under development. And then showcased. So it has been showcased to the product owner and, you know, feedback has been incorporated. Migration ready means it's ready to be migrated to the QA environment. It's in QA means the QA team, the testers are executing test cases and testing the story. QA complete means the end-to-end testing has been done for this user story. PO tested means the product owner successfully performs POT, means product owner testing, and he has found all the defects and then PO tested means the product owner is happy. Otherwise, we say POT failed means product owner has found some defects. So the testers say they've already tested it, but then the product owner tests it and he says, hey, you know what? You guys didn't do the good job on testing. We found a lot more defects. And so they mark it POT failed, and then it has to go back into development again. And after POT tested, at the end of the sprint demo, sometimes there might be a glitch in the demo. They're not able to demo it, so the story may not be closed out. So only if the story has been demoed successfully in the sprint demo, at the end, if the product owners and the team members say okay, then the Scrum Master says, you know, or the business analyst marks the story closed. So that's the user story lifecycle. So at the end of every sprint, while publishing the metrics, we have to put in the reason for as to why a particular story was not closed out. So either it was rejected, meaning they developed the story and then in the demo they showcased it to the team, the product owners, and the team did not deliver the functionality specified in the story. They asked for something and the team misunderstood it and they delivered something else. It was kind of off the mark, so it was rejected outright by the product owners. So that's the reason the story didn't get closed out, meaning either the developers didn't understand what the requirements were, or for whatever reason, they didn't deliver what the specifications asked for. So it was rejected in the demo. Incomplete. So usually when the team did not have enough time to fully complete and develop and test the story. So the story was 80% done, but then it was incomplete. We didn't have time to complete it for whatever reason. And then the next one is not closed. So story is neither incomplete nor rejected, but it's not closed due to some other reason. Absence of key team members. So the story was fully done and everything, but then some key members were missing. So say the tester had to go on leave, and so the testing could not be done, so the story could not be closed out. There's open P1 or P2 defects in the story. They thought they had all developed and tested and everything, but there's one P1, P2 defect still open. So for that reason, the story could not be closed out. Unavailability of some third-party software. The story is all done, but then we don't have the software that we need to, you know, deliver this functionality. So the story was not able to, you know, we couldn't, you know, close out this user story. Dependency on some other story that was not completed on time. So within a sprint, this particular story was not done, and therefore the story could not be done. So for whatever reason, various reasons, for every story that was not closed out successfully, we have to maintain a log. And we can put it in Rally or Jira, you know, the Scrum Master has to consolidate all this from all the business analysts and maintain a log saying why each story was not closed out. This is useful for future reference. Obsolete user stories. Sometimes the product owners write a user story and then they develop it, test it, close it out and it's fine. But after 4 months they realize they want to do it the same thing in a different way. So they replace the story with another story. So this earlier story becomes obsolete or invalid. What do you do with obsolete stories? Usually we put it in the title saying replaced by this newer story number, and then we move it to the parking lot. So we can also tag. We can use something called tags. Tag them as invalid or tag them as obsolete. So that's another way. Remember to update the test cases along with the story that has been overwritten or rendered obsolete. So if a particular story was rendered obsolete, so the next, whatever story was, you know, newly written to override the story, that story will have test cases, right? So when you move a older story, obsolete story to the parking lot, remember to move the test cases that were associated with the story also to the parking lot. And if there were test cases that spanned across multiple stories, including the obsolete story, make sure you update those test cases accordingly. Removing unwanted user stories. User story may be removed, you know, by just like deleting it and putting it in the trash bin, or we might mark it invalid, or we might write, you know, we just put it in the parking lot, or you can just remove it from the sprint bucket and dump it in the product backlog to be reviewed later. But then at some point, all the stories in the product backlog must be in some sprint backlog and closed out. So if the story is never going to be done, you don't want it to be done, then you put it in a folder called a parking lot. So log and categorize defects. So defects might be found during the QA testing process by the testers or by the product owners during the UAT. So we mark the, we log defects, we categorize them, and you know, they should always indicate in which environment they found the defect, and they must retest the defect in the same environment in which it was found, and then they must close it up. So daily bug triage. I've talked about this in detail in my QA best practices training about defect management. So all the team members participate in this bug triage. It may not be daily, it can also be like once a week or twice a week or thrice a week, depending on how often it needs to be done. So it's usually like a 1 hour meeting where the product owners, the technical architects, the scrum master, the QA leads, the dev leads, they're all, the BSAs, they're all in the room, and then whoever has found defects in this previous time period, they discuss all the defects that are that have been submitted, and they go over them and try to identify the root cause. Sometimes it seems like a really simple defect, but the technical architect might say, hey, you know what, this points out to a very major underlying architectural flaw. And the product owner may say, you know what, I never thought about how this would impact the other module. So in the bug triage, we do the root cause analysis, assign bugs to the developers to fix, and then make sure the bugs are closed out on time. So the hot potato feature, we talked about this earlier. So instead of team members walking up to each other or sending emails saying, hey, you know what, I want you to work on this story, I want you to go retest this defect, instead of, you know, sending these messages to each other, they have something called a hot potato on a user story. It's a drop down with all the team members' names. So if A wants to give a hot potato to B, what it means is they picked B's name in the hot potato drop down, and they put in the note saying, in the blocked reason, they say, or they just put their name and initials and in a particular note section, and they say, you know what, I want you to populate the architectural details for the story. So immediately Rally or whichever tool will send a notification. We have to set up these notifications. So the Scrum Master has to make sure that all the team members set up these hot potato notifications. And then they get a notification saying, you know, you're supposed to work on this. So they get, they say, I have a hot potato for user story number 1234. Okay, so they within 24 hours, they're supposed to respond to the hot potatoes. And if a hot potato response has not been received, and then the Scrum Master has to go and chase them down saying, hey, you have this hot potato, you're supposed to work on it and stuff. And what do they do after responding to a hot potato? They give it back to the person who gave it to them. So suppose A gives B a hot potato, B responds and gives the hot potato back to A. It means in the drop down, they pick A's name and give the hot potato back to A. And then A gets the hot potato, and then A reviews what B has given, and then A says, this is what you gave, but if he got what he wanted, he says, okay, so I don't need to give the hot potato to anyone, and so he just takes off the hot potato from the story, and the story is no longer blocked. Otherwise, he might block it and give the hot potato back to the same person, saying, no, you didn't really give me what I asked for, and he re-specifies what he wants. And again, the person responds. Or sometimes he may say, you know what, you're not the right person for this, so he blocks it and gives the hot potato to somebody else. So only the person who originated the hot potato gets to take off the hot potato. So when somebody responds to a hot potato, it's like an action item. Somebody responds, they're not supposed to take off the hot potato. They're supposed to give it back to the person who requested the information, who gave them the hot potato. So this is the process of blocking and unblocking user stories using hot potatoes. This is a way of automating communication in a team. So UAT happens at the end of all the sprints. It may happen for 1 month or 2 months or 4 months, depending on the complexity of the project. That's where they have specific UAT testers and they have product owners. They play around in the system and do complete end-to-end system testing. And they find a lot of defects which the testers might have missed. And they may have preset criteria saying, no P1, P2 defects must be open for the UAT to be successful and closed out. And then, so when all the UAT defects are fixed and the UAT is officially signed off, then they migrate the code to production. Hot fixes. So once the code is on production, so it's live up there. So somebody is not able to create a new case, somebody is not able to save their profile. These are all big bugs. So there's usually a specific team of two or three people called the Tiger team or the hotfix team. So whatever defects are found on production, they fix them right there in a particular sandbox and then put it out production. Nobody usually fixes bugs directly on production. They may not do it in development, again go to QA, again go to UAT, again production. So there's usually a separate sandbox where they fix the code and then put it directly into production. That's called hot fixes. This brings us to the end of the Agile best practices training. And for those of you who plan to become Scrum Masters, if you've been working as a business analyst or a QA lead or a developer for a while in an Agile project, you might have observed how Scrum Masters work. And if you want to scale up to be a Scrum Master, I hope this training helps you in understanding the roles and responsibilities of a Scrum Master and how Agile methodology works. So this is a generic, you know, a best practices training on Agile methodology, and it's done slightly differently in different projects and different companies. We customize it for different clients, you know, to suit their requirements, but this is an overview of how Agile methodology works. Thank you.